In this video, I shall be talking about acute flaccid paralysis. This is very important both from practical examination point of view as well as for your clinical practice later in life. Hence, I suggest you pay complete attention. The video also includes excerpts from the IAP National Treatment Guidelines 2024 on acute flaccid paralysis. Before that, I would simply like to express my gratitude to all of you for being highly appreciative of my endeavor. I request you to share and subscribe maximally so that we begin managing patients with conceptual clarity in place of merely following the guidelines verbatim. Let us first understand the terminology. Acute means onset less than 14 days of duration. Flaccid means hypotonia, and paralysis is motor weakness, maximum severity of which may be reached in days to weeks. Actually, it is a misnomer. It can be paralysis or it can be paresis. Paresis is partial weakness, which is the case in most of the time, which is the fact in most of the cases. Paralysis is complete loss of power. AFP is defined as a child under 15 years of age presenting with sudden onset of floppy paralysis or muscle weakness due to any cause, either this or any person of any age with paralytic illness if a clinician suspects poliomyelitis. India was declared polio-free by the World Health Organization since 2014. The last case was reported from Howrah, West Bengal in 2011. I read it somewhere, don't know where, that disease-free status is afforded 3 years after isolation of the last case. Hence, we were declared polio-free in 2014. Even when the last case was isolated in 2011. The number of AFP, that is AFP from non-polio causes, isolated in 2023 in India was 7.46 per 100,000 cases. A case of circulating vaccine-derived poliovirus was reported in Meghalaya in 2024, but it not being wild, India's polio-free status remains unaffected. This image in the backdrop shows the polio vaccination travel requirements, thereby implying areas still at high risk of acquisition of poliovirus infection. Causes of acute flaccid paralysis can be categorized based on the site in the neuronal pathway where the disease is. Accordingly, the central causes can be brainstem encephalitis, acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, neuromyelitis optica, stroke, tumor, abscess, cerebral sinovenous thrombosis. Spinal causes include acute transverse myelitis, acute myelopathy, cord compression syndrome. Causes involving the anterior horn cell are poliomyelitis, non-polio enterovirus, rabies, varicella zoster. Peripheral nerve include Guillain-Barré syndrome, which is a radiculopathy, traumatic neuritis, and toxic neuropathies like diphtheria, tick bite, lead and arsenic poisoning. Involving neuromuscular junction include myasthenia gravis, botulism, snake bite and organophosphorus poisoning. And those involving the muscle directly are viral myositis, hypokalemic periodic paralysis, McArdle's disease, polymyositis and critical illness myopathy. A patient with AFP will present with the chief complaints of inability to walk or stand, weakness of upper and lower limbs, breathing difficulty, difficulty in swallowing, change in voice, facial deviation, loss of bowel and bladder control. Onset can be hyperacute, that is within few minutes, which suggests a vascular pathology, or it can be acute, that is from few hours to days, generally less than 7 to 14 days, as is seen in Guillain-Barré syndrome, polio and acute transverse myelitis, or the onset can be insidious over a few days, for example, tick paralysis. Progression can be ascending, which is symmetrical in case of Guillain-Barré syndrome, asymmetrical to begin with, may be seen in some cases of GBS. Asymmetrical ascending paralysis is typical of poliomyelitis. Descending paralysis is seen in diphtheria and botulism. Episodic paralysis is seen in hypokalemic periodic paralysis. Recurrent paralysis is seen in CSCNA 1A related channelopathies. Clinical clues to diagnosis. For instance, in patients with a preceding history of diarrheal illness, you may suspect GBS. In patients with bull neck fever and throat pain in the preceding week, you suspect diphtheria. Patients with a history of recent intramuscular injection, you suspect traumatic neuritis. Patients with a history of trauma to spine and neck, you suspect traumatic myelopathy. History of recent dog bite or travel to hilly areas, you suspect rabies or tick bite paralysis. Sudden onset weakness in the morning after a carbohydrate-rich diet in the night may be suggestive of hypokalemic periodic paralysis. Predominantly, sensory symptoms suggest occupational exposures, for example, arsenic and lead. Onset of weakness immediately after heavy exercise or running suggests glycogen storage disorders. History of consumption of canned foods, ingestion of contaminated honey suggests botulism. History of prolonged ICU stay, use of corticosteroids and neuromuscular blockers suggests critical illness polyneuropathy. And similar episodes in the past, history of specific, non-specific abdominal pain and photosensitivity may suggest acute intermittent porphyria. Some clues on clinical examination include asymmetric and patchy motor weakness with complete sensory sparing is suggestive of poliomyelitis. Symmetric motor ascending weakness with or without sensory involvement suggests GBS. Ptosis, extraocular weakness, diplopia with diurnal variation suggests myasthenia gravis, which may present as myasthenic crisis. Muscle weakness with sudden ptosis and extraocular muscle weakness suggests snake bite, neurotoxic type, and rabies, a dumb rabies. Bulbar onset of weakness may suggest post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy or botulism. Cranial nerve involvement may suggest tick paralysis, post-diphtheritic polyneuropathy, Guillain-Barré syndrome, acute flaccid myelitis, and Lyme's disease. And early bladder involvement, especially retention, would suggest acute transverse myelitis, and it can be seen in 15% of cases with Guillain-Barré syndrome as well. Though there are several causes of AFP, there are four characteristic causes which are generally discussed as a representation of others, and these primarily are based on the site of involvement. For example, in polio, involvement is the anterior horn cell. Progression of paralysis occurs over 24 to 48 hours. It is asymmetrical patchy paralysis. Deep tendon reflexes are absent. Cranial nerve involvement may be present. Respiratory insufficiency may be seen due to bulbar and bulbospinal involvement. Babinski's reflex is not elicitable. And sensory involvement suggests myalgia, but no typical sensory involvement is seen. Bladder retention is typically absent. So polio is pure motor paralysis. Investigative workup would include TLC elevated in CSF, normal protein or slightly increased protein. EMG done at an interval of 3 weeks from the onset would be abnormal. NCV at 3 weeks would be normal because it is a muscle involvement, anterior horn cell involvement. The sequelae of poliomyelitis will be there in the form of severe asymmetrical atrophy and muscle paralysis. Then Guillain-Barré syndrome involves the nerve root. Progression again may take the same duration. The distribution is symmetric and ascending. Deep tendon reflexes are absent. Cranial nerve involvement may or may not be present depending on the type of GBS. Respiratory insufficiency may be seen in severe cases when the paralysis has extended up to the bulbar, involving the bulb or the diaphragm. Babinski reflex is absent. Sensory involvement may be seen in the form of cramps, tingling, and hypoesthesia of palms and soles or in Amsan. Bladder retention, if present, is transient and is generally seen in 15% of cases. CSF would be suggestive of albuminocytological dissociation, that is less than 10 WBCs per cubic millimeter. It is done in the second or third week of illness. EMG is normal. NCV is abnormal and it may show axonal or demyelinating pattern. The sequelae is of symmetrical distal limb atrophy. But this sequelae is also transient. Traumatic neuritis involves the peripheral nerves, progresses over hours to days. The weakness is distributed along the involved nerve. Deep tendon reflexes are decreased or absent. Cranial nerve involvement is absent. Respiratory insufficiency is not there because it is involving the peripheral nerves. Babinski reflex is absent. Sensory involvement includes pain along the nerve distribution, gluteal region in case of intramuscular injection, and bladder retention is absent. CSF would be normal. EMG may be abnormal depending on the involvement of co-involvement of the muscles. NCV would definitely be abnormal because it is the nerve which is being involved, and the sequelae will be a moderate atrophy of the distal muscles. Transverse myelitis involves the spinal cord. Progression may be over hours to days. Distribution is symmetric lower limb. Deep tendon reflexes are absent early, but hyperreflexia may be seen later because it being a spastic type of paralysis in the lower limbs later on. Cranial nerve involvement is not there. Respiratory insufficiency may be seen at times depending on the level where the myelitis has occurred, especially if it is the cervical level involving C3, C4. Babinski reflex is present. Sensory involvement is manifested as anesthesia of lower limbs with sensory level at the level at the typical sensory level of spine. Bladder retention is present, and CSF may be normal or may show slight increase in lymphocytes. Proteins may be normal to slightly raised. EMG and NCV are normal, and the sequelae is in the form of diplegia and atrophy after several years. MRI brain and spine is a supportive investigation which can help localize various demyelinating disorders. For example, nerve root enhancement will be seen in GBS, which is a radiculopathy. Blood investigations in the form of CBC, ESR, electrolytes and CPK may be done to delineate the exact cause, and specific investigations may also need to be done depending on the clinician's suspicion. For example, blood lead levels and suspected lead poisoning. Nerve conduction studies, the results may be normal at the onset of illness, hence it is better to repeat after 2 to 3 weeks. The common findings on NCV and their interpretation are as follows. If only compound muscle action potential is reduced, you suspect an acute motor axonal neuropathy. If both CMAP and SNAP is SNAP, that is sensory nerve action potential, are reduced, you suspect acute motor sensory axonal neuropathy. If there is increased distal latency with decreased conduction velocity, or there is temporal dispersion, F wave latency and conduction block, you will suggest acute inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy. Specific treatment comprises of intravenous immunoglobulin for GBS, methylprednisolone for transverse myelitis. You may do plasma exchange or IV cyclophosphamide may also be given. Compressive myelopathy, you do spinal decompression. Anti-snake venom and a trial of atropine neostigmine for snake bites, especially neurotoxic ones, and antitoxin for botulism. EDTA is given as a chelating agent for lead poisoning. Supportive management, on the other hand, includes ensuring neutral positioning of the limbs and splinting to prevent contractures, chest and limb physiotherapy, prevention of bed sores, the risk being due to prolonged bedridden state, urinary catheterization, analgesics, and nutritional rehabilitation. Ensuring a protein-rich but a balanced diet should definitely be there. Daily monitoring should include vitals assessment for assessing the early onset of autonomic instability, muscle power charting to monitor progression of weakness and power of muscles, gag reflex to assess the bulbar involvement, deep tendon reflexes to assess clinical improvement or deterioration further, and checking for bed sores and contractures. The Government of India carries out routine surveillance of acute flaccid paralysis. It is an important tool for the early detection and prevention of the community spread of polio. Surveillance system needs to be sensitive enough to detect at least one non-polio AFP case each year for every 100,000 children under the age of 15 years. That is why AFP reporting becomes very, very important on part of the clinician. Global Polio Eradication Initiative aims to confirm and sequence all polio viruses isolated within 35 days of the onset of paralysis, and the process from the onset of paralysis to the arrival of stool specimens at a WHO-accredited polio lab must be completed within a stipulated time of 14 days. Hence, we must always remember and keep a high suspicion, vigilance and suspicion to remember and report any case of flaccid paralysis to the district or the local authorities. The steps involved in AFP surveillance are finding and reporting cases. Children less than 15 years of age must be reported to the surveillance officers even if the clinician has ruled out polio clinically. Step 2 includes transporting the stool samples for analysis. Two stool specimens are taken 24 to 48 hours apart sealed in containers and stored immediately inside a refrigerator or packed in between ice packs at 4 to 8 degrees centigrade in a cold box. The specimen should reach the lab within 72 hours of collection, and this is what is referred to as reverse cold chain. Step 3 is isolating the virus, which is done from the stool sample. If isolated, the virus should be classified as wild type or vaccine derived. Step 4 includes mapping the virus along with the response. If confirmed, efforts are made to identify as to where did the virus originate, and rapid outbreak response measures including supplementary immunization activities are then implemented. Summarizing the common illnesses which affect the various sites causing acute flaccid paralysis. First is the anterior horn cell. The genetic causes of which are spinal muscular atrophy, and the acquired causes is a poliomyelitis. The characteristic features are asymmetric patchy motor weakness. The second site is the peripheral nerve, characteristic example being Guillain-Barré syndrome. The characteristic features are generally symmetrical motor sensory or sensory motor weakness, motor or sensory motor weakness. Weakness begins distally and progresses in an ascending fashion. Besides GBS, some genetic causes can be there, for example, Charcot-Marie-Tooth disease, hereditary sensory autonomic neuropathies, neurodegenerative disorders, and hereditary ataxias. The third site of involvement is the neuromuscular junction, characteristic examples being botulism and myasthenia. The features being characteristic diurnal variation with weakness increasing over the day and decremental response on repetitive nerve stimulation test. The last site of involvement causing AFP is muscle, the characteristic example of which is myositis and myopathies. The characteristic features of this kind of paralysis are weakness is proximal, usually asymmetrical, and is generally pure motor. Thank you so very much for a very patient listening and watching. If you did like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe the video for more similar and related content. Thank you. Namaskar.